Welcome to church today. We gathered again to worship the Lord who has given us life and the promise of new life, just as we've been doing throughout this pandemic. You know, there's an adage that was included in a song years ago that said, when God closes a door, he opens a window. And the pandemic certainly closed the door, if you will, on regular gatherings for worship, but we crawled right through that window and we found a way to continue to lift up the name of the Lord. So we have those of you here today and all of you who are joining us on Facebook, we welcome you all. And for those on Facebook, if you're a visitor today, we'd like to invite you to sign that little form that pops up on the feed there that you see, and that'll give us a chance to reach out to you this week and let you know what a delight it is to have you with us in worship, whether we're here physically or we're here through social media. We have gathered to worship God. It is good. But this is the third Sunday in Lent, so we're continuing our journey through the Lenten season. And are there any announcements that we need to highlight today? Any that we need to highlight? Because if not, well then let's give each other a wonderful socially distanced greeting in the love of Christ, and we'll prepare our hearts for the beautiful prelude that Jonathan and Noel have prepared for us.
Thank you. heavens are telling the glory of God, and the firmament proclaims his handiwork.
The law of the Lord is perfect, uprighting the soul.
The decrees of the Lord are sure, making wise the simple. More to be desired are they than gold.
But the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart is acceptable to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer.
Amen.
Utterance of wisdom, and to another, the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the one Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another the discernment of spirits, to another various kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. All these are activated by one and the same Spirit, who allots to each one individually, just as the Spirit chooses.
Thank you.
But our scripture reading today is from the Old Testament book of 1 Kings. And we're continuing our study of this Bronze Age king named Solomon, whose name is derived from the Hebrew word shalom, peace is somewhat a decent translation. It means more than that. It means overall well-being. And that's what his name means. But as we've seen, Solomon was a human being like anyone else. And we continue to learn from his life today as we study his wisdom, about which we read in chapter 3, verses 16 through 28. We read, "Later, two women who were prostitutes came to the king and stood before him. The one woman said, 'Please, my lord, this woman and I live in the same house, and I gave birth while she was in the house. Then on the third day after I gave birth, this woman also gave birth. We were together. There was no one else with us in the house. Only the two of us were in the house. Then this woman's son died in the night because she lay on him. She got up in the middle of the night and took my son from beside me while your servant slept. She laid him at her breast and laid her dead son at my breast. When I rose in the morning to nurse my son, I saw that he was dead. But when I looked at him closely in the morning, clearly it was not the son I had born. But the other woman said, 'No, the living son is mine, and the dead son is yours.' The first said, 'No, the dead son is yours, and the living son is mine.' So they argued before the king. Then the king said, 'The one says, this is my son that is alive, and your son is dead. While the other says, not so. Your son is dead, and my son is the living one.' So the king said, 'Bring me a sword.' And they brought a sword before the king. The king said, 'Divide the living boy in two, then give half to the one and half to the other.' But the woman whose son was alive said to the king, 'Because compassion for her son burned within her, please, my lord, give her the living boy. Certainly, do not kill him.' The other said, 'It shall be neither mine nor yours. Divide it.' Then the king responded, 'Give the first woman the living boy. Do not kill him. She is his mother.' All Israel heard of the judgment that the king had rendered, and they stood in awe of the king, because they perceived that the wisdom of God was in him to execute justice." May God add blessing to the reading of his sacred word. Let's pause for a moment of prayer. O gracious and loving God, we give you thanks again today for this sacred season Lent, and this opportunity as we stumble through the challenges in our lives right now, that the world is laid before us, a chance in the midst of that to reach up to you, to say, Lord, we need you, and we need your grace every moment of our lives. We ask you to meet with us together in this place, and as we gather throughout our community, nation, we pray that you be with us and fill us with your grace to overflow. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, today I'll be sharing bless the people of Israel. Reading 1 Kings chapter 3, verse 3, Solomon loved the Lord, walking in the statutes of David, his father. But his many virtues aside, Solomon also did things that completely messed up people's lives. And toward the end of his life, he even participated, as we'll see in a few weeks, in some terribly despicable things which helped contribute to the division of the Israelite kingdom into two separate kingdoms after his death. So Solomon, like all people, was a big mix. And as we discussed last week, most of the mistakes that Solomon made arose from the same source. It was his unquenchable desire to control everything and everybody. He didn't have that balance that we talked about in working to control those things we can in life for everyone's benefit, while trusting God when it comes to those things that are outside of our control. Just letting go and placing those things in God's hand. Solomon didn't have that balance, and it is, to be truthful, a tough balance to achieve, because it differs from person to person and even from situation to situation, but achieving it is vital. That's been especially true during this pandemic. Understanding what we have control over and what we don't, and making sure to act in both of those ways that are appropriate, that helps us move through this in a peaceful way, will continue to be true as this pandemic one day reaches its end and we heal, move on with our lives. But again, one of the ways that God's Spirit helps us achieve this balance is by giving us examples in Scripture of people who got it right and others who totally screwed it up. And King Solomon, as I said, is one of those who totally screwed it up when it came to just letting certain things go and trusting God. Remember, Scripture did not cancel anyone for certain events in their life. What they did was just tell the whole story, lay it all out there, and let us see what we can learn from the good and from the bad. And last week, we learned how this caused problems, Solomon's approach to life, as he rose to power in the first place. And today, we'll see how it impacted the use of his wisdom. Now, I'll say right away, from the get-go, that one of Solomon's greatest strengths was his wisdom. It's a spiritual gift that has blessed people throughout time, and it continues to bless us to this day. In chapter 3, the story goes, in the book of 1 Kings, we're told that when God appeared to Solomon in the dream, Solomon asked specifically for wisdom. Why? It was to rule God's people justly. And God was impressed with this request. Solomon had asked for riches and power and all these things that some other kings might ask for. He asked for wisdom to rule justly. And God far surpasses the report that I heard. Not a bad assessment from a fellow powerful monarch. I mean, not bad at all, but even our civilization itself, Western civilization, has been built in part upon the principles, many of the sayings attributed to Solomon in Scripture. You know, we like to talk about some of the ancient people who laid the initial groundwork for our culture. You know, people like Aristotle, Plato, and the like. But if we examine closely enough, a lot of what we believe, not only as Christians, but across Western culture, a lot of what many of us consider what you call common sense, just things that people know, a lot of that isn't so common, really, at all. We'll find the wisdom of Solomon a source of more than we might expect. So King Solomon has had an enormous impact on our culture. He was wise, and he used that gift in many good ways, most of the time. but not all of the time. And I believe that the book of 1 Kings highlights that Solomon didn't always use his wisdom well. How does it highlight that? Well, the only specific example that the book of 1 Kings gives us of Solomon's use of wisdom is the passage that we read this morning. The famous story of two women who brought a baby before Solomon. Scholars examine this material. They believe that it was part of a much larger collection of the account of judgments that Solomon had made. Which begs the question in my mind, why choose this story as an example of Solomon's wisdom? Because I'll be honest with you guys, I think the decision that Solomon makes in this story is really, really messed up. It's depraved on many levels. You see, sometimes Scripture tells us plainly when someone does something that's a little off. And it explicitly tells us that it's sharing an example in that moment of a mistake that a person has made. For instance, another king called Ahab ruled years after Solomon in the northern kingdom of Israel. And this is how Scripture begins its discussion of Ahab's reign. It says, Ahab did evil in the sight of the Lord more than all who were before him. That's Scripture's introductory note about this guy. So sometimes it's very blunt when describing when someone has done something wrong or is in the story going to be doing something wrong. But other times Scripture just recounts the story about a person and lets us, the readers or the hearers in the ancient world, those people didn't read it or heard the story, let us draw the obvious conclusion ourselves that there's something wrong with what the person did. And I think that's the case with this story about these two ladies and this baby. See, in verse 16, these two women are described as zanot in the text, a word that referred to someone who frequently had intimate relations outside of marriage. And our English translations use this word I hate. They use the word prostitute to describe these women, and it bugs me. It bugs me to no end because the Hebrew word isn't that specific. These ladies weren't necessarily prostitutes. We don't know their whole situation by any means. But at any rate, one of the women, let's call her the plaintiff in the case, she tells Solomon that each of them gave birth to a baby in the same house, where no one else except two of them was present for the births. And tragically, the other woman He also could have convened a committee of people tasked with examining the living child, the little boy, to at least attempt to determine which woman the child looked more like. Now, I know DNA testing was unavailable 3,000 years ago, and it may have been impossible to determine who the baby looked more like. I mean, this might have been a fruitless task. But sometimes it is easy to tell who a child looks like. I remember years ago, when I was younger, I met a very sweet family with four boys who were four different ages, a one-year-old all the way up to an eight-year-old. And all these kids, they had the exact same face. They had the father's face. I mean, even the baby had the father's face, the man's face. It was creepy. It was almost as if someone put a mask on these children of the father's face. And so sometimes it's easy to tell if a child and parent belong together. And me, I'm certain that their father never had a problem picking up his kids from school. That child belongs to that man, definitely. But if neither of those things worked, okay, Solomon, worst case scenario, Solomon put an order that the child be cared for by a third person for a time, like an ancient foster parent, a stand-in parent, to give each of these ladies some time to admit one of them was lying, because somebody was lying. But they'd both been through a terribly traumatic situation, and it takes time for all of us to heal when we've gone through that, and that may have been why someone was lying, and if you give it time, maybe the truth would have come out while someone else was caring for the baby. Solomon, he could have handled the situation in these and any other number of helpful ways, but instead, verse 24 quotes him as saying, "Bring me a sword." What? And after which Solomon says, "Divide the living boy in two, then give half to the one and half to the other." And so Solomon immediately transforms a custody dispute into a scene from the Texas Chainsaw Massacre. I mean, all he needed was Leatherface as one of the guards. And at this point, one of the women pleads with Solomon not to kill the child, even offering to give the living child to the other woman. But the other woman says she doesn't care if the child dies or not. So Solomon then determines, with this sword, you know, there, waving around, that the woman who wants the child to remain alive is the true mother. This scene, it's been depicted in many different paintings and other artwork over the years. It's a colorful scene, and I've placed one such painting in your bulletin today. It's on page 6 for you to look at. But here's some food for thought. What if both of these women didn't want the baby to be cut in half? Because, well, many people wouldn't want a baby to be cut in half, whether they were the parents or not. If this happened, Solomon would be no closer to determining who the mother was, according to his logic, you know, his little plan he had here. But secondly, what if both of these people were nuts and both didn't care if the baby was cut in half? Would Solomon then have gone ahead and cut the baby in half to save face? You know, because that's what he said he did. He's got to follow through, or no one's going to believe in anything he says. So he'd have done that. But most importantly to me, what about the baby's opinion in all this? Just because he couldn't talk yet didn't mean he shouldn't have a say about whether his ability to remain in one piece or not was an option being considered by all these adults. And there's little about this decision that seems very because they perceived that the wisdom of God was in him to execute justice. They perceived that the wisdom of God was in him. Notice the text conspicuously doesn't tell us what God felt about this crazy decision, only that popular sentiment was on Solomon's side. I mean, this story, after I heard it in Sunday school the first time, it used to give me nightmares as a child. I used to have dreams about half babies. It's just terrible. And I believe that the scripture's point in including it here is to demonstrate that even though Solomon was wise, he again allowed his desire to control within his dominion, he allowed that to corrupt even the use of his wisdom, his great spiritual gift at times, in situations where he could otherwise have been a great blessing to others. See, Solomon obviously felt that he had complete control over the life of that innocent child, that he could do anything that he wanted to him. And this is the same attitude that the Egyptian pharaoh had toward Hebrew babies when he tried to have them killed before the Exodus. We read in that story. It's also the same attitude that Herod, when Jesus did, had when he issued the same command for these children to be killed. And both of those actions were condemned as evil by Scripture because they were. And sadly, Solomon in this instance, on a much smaller scale, was acting just like that. That power and control he had over life and death was obviously more important to him than everybody there that day remaining in one piece after his judgment. And when we exercise our talents with the same imbalanced approach for control in our lives, we can also end up hurting people. Maybe not cutting babies in half, but we can end up hurting people as well. Scripture tells us that God gives us all spiritual gifts and encourages us to use them for the good of each other. As Carolyn read for us today from St. Paul's letter, there are different kinds of gifts that the same Spirit distributes. Now, each one, the manifestation of the Spirit, is given for the common good. And you see, it's balancing our desire to control, unlike Solomon did in the instance we examined today, that helps us use those gifts. All the different gifts each of us has, use them effectively. Not using our gifts when it's needed. That tests God. But using them to control or manipulate others without regard for their well-being, as Solomon did in that instance we read today, well, that reveals a lack of trust in God to care for everyone. So our passage today challenges us to ask ourselves, how and why do I share my use? Do I share it for the right reasons? Well, in addition to being wise, Solomon was also extraordinarily rich. Next week, we're going to explore some of the good ways he used his wealth, but also some of the not so good ways he used it, because there is, again, a lot we can learn from both. Amen.
Let us give thanks to the Lord through the giving of our gifts.
Thank you.
People give for so many reasons: guilt, joy, obligation, gratitude, obedience, hope, control, thankfulness. Remind us that all the things we possess are gifts from you, and you call us to use them wisely, to share them openly, to give them generously. It's in this spirit we ask you to receive, bless, and use this offering today. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Well, let's now prepare our hearts to receive the Holy Sacrament of Communion. You know, through Communion we can see so many things, so many principles of our faith are embedded in it. And one of those we can see is differentiated from what happened in our story today with Solomon and the ladies with the baby. Jesus sacrificed himself for us. And that is the greatest kind of sacrifice that we can make for others, to follow in our Lord's footsteps. Unlike King Solomon, who was more than willing to sacrifice somebody else's life, that baby's, for his and other people's good, unlike that, self-sacrifice is a noble thing. It's a gift we can give to others. That's one of many, many truths that we can glean through this incredible act that Christ did for us, that has reminded us of God's love that washes away our sins and gives us forgiveness. So let's prepare our hearts to reflect upon this holy meal today. And let's do so with a moment of silence, and then I'll invite you to join me in our communion liturgy. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to God Most High.
It is right.
Well, Scripture tells us that on the night that our Lord was betrayed, as he prepared his heart to give his life for us the very next day, he took bread from the dinner table, and giving thanks to God, he broke it. And he said, "This is my body that's broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After dinner, Christ, he took a cup from the table, that Passover meal, and passing it to his disciples, he said, "This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. Drink this in remembrance of me." Let us pray. Oh, gracious and loving God, we give you thanks today. We give you thanks beyond words today for the examples in Scripture you've given us of what it means to live faithfully and what it means to live unfaithfully. We pray, O God, that you would help us to be like Christ, to exercise our love for others sacrificially without cost to others' well-being. We pray that you help us learn today from Solomon's mistakes in this way, and help us find balance in our life that causes us not to make those same unhelpful decisions in our lives. Bless us and fill us with this grace as we receive these holy elements today. These things we ask in Christ's name, and now we pray as he taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. The table of our Lord is ready. I invite you right now to take with me the bread, the body of Christ, broken for us, and let us eat it.
Thank you.
God as faithfully as we can with the help of His Spirit. Amen.